Hey, this is Roaming Millennial. Welcome back to my channel. Today, we are going to be talking about what could happen if you, gentle viewer, fail to disavow those dangerous ideas that are going around. And I would like to give a quick thank you to our sponsors, Trade Genius. They have an algorithm that predicts market behaviors, giving members alerts about the best times to buy and sell their commodities. It's a great way to get started if you're interested in trading stocks or cryptocurrencies. Plus, they also have a ton of online classes if you want to know more about financial markets and trading. So if you or someone you know is looking to make investments, you should definitely check them out, and I will leave a link to them in the description box. So first things first, I want to give you all some backstory about this video. Earlier this year, in what seems like a lifetime ago, I was lucky enough to snag an interview with the infamous Richard Spencer. He's one of the main figureheads of the alt-right, and I'm guessing that by now most of, if not all of you, have already heard of him. Regardless of how you may feel about him personally or his views, he's a pretty big deal in terms of notoriety and recognition. He's had pieces about him and interviews featured by major mainstream media news outlets. And as someone who had released videos on their channel before trying to explain what the alt-right was, I thought interviewing him would be a great opportunity to provide more information to my subscribers, and quite frankly, I was pretty shocked when he agreed to it. I'm sure you guys understand that I am still an extremely small channel, especially by major news network standards, but even by YouTube standards. So when a noted political figure who's been on CNN and Al Jazeera agrees to come onto my channel, yeah, that is a big deal to me. Anyway, we did end up doing the interview, and I did my best to ask the questions that you guys had sent me on Twitter, and that I thought would provide the most insight into Richard Spencer as a person and the alt-right movement as a whole. Not to toot my own horn, but I thought I did a pretty good job being fair, but also asking about inconsistencies where I saw them.
But it seems like you're talking about sort of a pan-Europeanism. But how would you respond to the fact that throughout history, most of the struggles and the conflicts that happened with European people have been with other Europeans? Because I've heard from the alt-right that if we're all racially homogenous, it just takes away that extra, I guess, point of conflict. But if we look, you know, throughout actually both world wars and even before that, just all of European history, it seems like white people haven't had really much of an issue fighting with each other. You know, the idea of resegregating countries that are racially heterogeneous like the United States. I mean, if you talk to the average like African American and offer them payment in exchange for going back to Africa, a place that their family hasn't been to for generations upon generations, maybe even longer than a lot of white people's families who've only come in the 1800s, I feel like that would be a really hard sell, especially to Africa. So I guess what would you do in instances like that? Or even, you know, more and more we're seeing interracial couples. I think it's something like almost 10%, and it's only rising. What position would that leave them in? You've been categorized as, quite frankly, a white supremacist by a lot of people. How would you respond to those kinds of claims? You know, because I think a lot of people, when they hear something like what you're advocating for, they might say, well, if you're not a white supremacist and you don't think these other races are inferior, why would you not want to live with them? Once this video is posted, there's going to be at least maybe a third of the people accusing me of being a white nationalist for having you on. I'm willing to talk to anybody. I don't think, you know, if your ideas really are as bad as they say, I don't think it's harmful for people to hear them, right? I mean, if they really are that toxic, I think people would recognize it, and if they're not, then what is the big deal?
But alas, a lot of people were not impressed, and that interview remains one of the most controversial things I've ever done on this channel, which is saying something considering some of the other videos that I've made. I guess you could say I like to keep things spicy. I hadn't even considered this perspective before, but some people allege that by having Richard Spencer on my channel and asking him questions about his ideology, I was actually, albeit in inadvertently pushing people toward white nationalism. And apparently this was also compounded by the fact that during the interview itself, I was not confrontational toward Spencer. And although that interview is definitely the most serious example of people accusing me of propping up or enabling dangerous ideas, I've also faced similar criticisms for other interviews I've done with people. When I had Dennis Prager on and asked him about God and religion, I was accused of promoting superstitious nonsense and religious babble. Conversely, when I had Michael Shermer on, some people asked why I, a Christian, would want to amplify the voice of such a rambunctious atheist. When I had Dr. Christina Hoff Sommers on, I was criticized for giving a platform to A, a Democrat, and B, a feminist, even a second wave one who really does believe in equality. And finally, every time I have Imam Tawhidi on my channel, I am accused of enabling Takiyo, which is lying for the sake of spreading Islam. I love the work I do for this channel. I love talking about these issues, making these videos, discussing different viewpoints with different people, but after a while, all the allegations of hate and white supremacy, they start to wear on you. You know, after a while, you've just got to wonder, is it me? Is there something to this? I mean, if one person calls you a bigot, I'm pretty sure you can just brush that off, but after a while it begins to look like a pattern. You've got to question things. And I hate to admit this, but there are times where I've wondered if maybe I'm being too controversial. Perhaps I'm stirring the pot too much. That maybe if I were to step back from things, I wouldn't attract so much drama and negativity. That's honestly what I would think about from time to time when I would see people writing things about me like this. But I'm happy to announce that I've decided to stop caring so much about what the reactionaries in this world think of me, thanks in part to Lindsay Shepherd. For anyone who's not familiar with the story, Lindsay Shepherd is a graduate student and TA at Wilfrid Laurier University in Canada. She recently got in trouble for showing a clip of a televised Jordan Peterson debate discussing pronoun usage to one of the classes she was teaching. Shepherd had the foresight to record the meeting of her being reprimanded by Laurier's staff, and frankly, it's shocking to listen to.
I was not taking sides. I was presenting both arguments.
So the thing is about this is, if you're presenting something like this, you have to think about the kind of teaching climate that you're creating. And this is actually, these arguments are counter to the Canadian Human Rights Code. So bringing something like that up in class, not critically, and I understand that you're trying to like...
It was critical. I introduced it critically.
How so?
It was in the spirit of debate.
Okay, in the spirit of the debate is slightly different than being like, okay, this is a problematic idea that we maybe want to unpack.
But that's taking sides. I know in my heart, and I know I expressed to the class, that I'm not transphobic. And if any of them, I don't know what they said, but I don't think I gave away any kind of political position of mine. I remained very neutral. And
that's kind of the problem.
There are many issues that need to be addressed in light of this case. Freedom of speech in academia, whether words can be violent, and of course the role of gender in our society. But what perhaps shocked me the most was Shepherd's professor taking issue with her presenting an idea with neutrality. Unfortunately, it seems to me that this story is just another example of failure to disavow being interpreted as approval for an idea by the regressive left. The criticisms that Lindsay faced were ones I've heard 100 times railed against me. That it's a mistake to present both of these ideas as if they were equally valid. That by talking about or featuring this person, you're just amplifying their hate. And look, it's one thing for me to hear these things after having Richard Spencer on my channel for an interview, but for Lindsay Shepherd to be told these things simply for featuring a clip of a Jordan Peterson debate, and by the way, Jordan Peterson is no Richard Spencer, it's just insane to me. This just illustrates the hostility to dissenting viewpoints that this social justice mentality has. Not only can you not promote wrongthink, but you can't even present it neutrally and even critically. It's sad to see that the progressive left is becoming so radicalized that those in the center and even the center left are now being called out for their failure of commitment to the cause. Because when you're dealing with ideologues and, yeah, cults, nothing short of constant disavowal of the opposition and constant reaffirmation of commitment to the cause is accepted. The argument that's made against those who entertain dangerous ideas and present both sides as if they were equally valid is that without guidance, people who are consuming that information, viewers, listeners, readers, whatever, might be inclined to choose the wrong ideology. I'm sorry, but that argument assumes that people have no agency or rationality of their own, that they have to be told what to think about everything. And I was thinking about this the other day, but look, throughout my entire time in school, elementary school, high school, university, anytime I was learning about Hitler or World War II, I'd love to know your experiences with this too, but I have honest to goodness never had a class or a lesson where it was explained to me why the genocide of the Jews was wrong. I have never had the academic arguments against what Hitler did laid out to me when we were learning about him, and yet, somehow, I do not support Hitler. It was almost as if, and this is gonna sound crazy, but hear me out, I was able to take the information that was presented to me, think critically about it, and decide whether or not it was something I supported. And I think what's even more worrying about the fact that the Shepherd incident takes place at a university is that in academia, we should not be teaching people what to think, but rather how to think. Higher education should not be something you attend just to learn what viewpoints are acceptable. And to those of you out there who are thinking to yourselves right now, screw taking a stance on the issues. Heck, screw even neutrality. I don't need that drama in my life. I'm just not gonna talk about it. I got some bad news because that is still not gonna save you. Recently, Taylor Swift, and yes, you heard that right, Taylor Swift, the pop singer, You know, that musician who writes about breaking up with her boyfriends and how Katy Perry has wronged her, has actually, and strangely enough, been dragged into the conversation surrounding race. Taylor Swift is one of those increasingly rare celebrities who actually makes it a point to not talk about politics in the fear of alienating her fans. Which, considering that she probably just wants to make music that people can enjoy, makes a lot of sense to me. However, that is just not good enough for some people.
Dear Taylor, this is a YouTube series where, through an open letter to you, I, Melissa A. Fabello, discuss social justice topics for other white feminists. And today, we're talking about whiteness. And how by not acknowledging it or actively working to dismantle it, we contribute to the oppression of people of color. And no, white supremacy doesn't just mean KKK members and neo-Nazis. White supremacy also takes the form of exotifying and objectifying the bodies of women of color, romanticizing and glamorizing European colonization, and using white fragility and victimhood to demonize people of color. And I'm sorry, Tay, but no, you cannot be excluded from this narrative.
So to sum up, you cannot be seen as being too sympathetic to the opposition, but you also can't be neutral when presented with the opposition, nor can you ignore the issue entirely. Politics is great, but seriously, in my opinion, conversations surrounding people not condemning something strongly enough or appearing to be too neutral on an issue are some of the biggest time wasters that I can imagine. How about, instead of trying to interpret what someone's position toward a given issue might be based on how we would react toward that issue if we were in the same position, we just, I don't know, discuss the issues. And I'm sorry for getting all fired up, but I've been thinking about this topic for a while. It affects my channel literally every day, and then just seeing that Lindsay Shepherd tape, or rather hearing it, just brought a lot of emotions about. But anyway, I would love to know what you guys think about this, the Laurier tape, and whether we have a responsibility to disavow dangerous ideas lest we be complicit in them. That's all for now. Thanks for watching, and a huge thank you to my patrons who support this channel and make these videos possible. If you like this, please subscribe to see more. I post new videos every week. I'll see you guys next time. Bye!